prefer to study is the wave functions for multi-electron systems. We know that for systems having many electrons, the electron repulsion terms must be included in the potential energy term of the wave function. For example, the potential energy for an electron labeled 1 in atomic unit can be written as the potential energy V that is equal to minus Z by R1 plus sigma J naught is equal to 1 into 1 by Rij, where R1 is the distance of the electron labeled 1 from the atomic nucleus of charge Z, and Rij is the inter-electronic distance between the electron 1 and the electron J. Every other electron will be subjected to a similar potential field in an atom, and therefore the potential energy of the system of multi-electrons in an atom of atomic number Z will be given by V that is equal to minus sigma I into Z by R1 plus 1 by 2 into sigma I naught equal to J 1 by Rij. Here the factor 1 by 2 in the second term is introduced to avoid each Rij term being counted twice in the summation. The Hamiltonian of such a system is then can be written as H cap that is equal to minus 1 by 2 sigma I del I square minus sigma I Z by R1 plus 1 by 2 sigma I naught equal to J 1 by Rij, where del I is the Laplacian, that is it is the kinetic energy operator for the electron I. The first term is the sum of the operators for the kinetic energy of the electrons. The rest of the terms gives the potential energy of the system. The second term gives the sum of the attractive energies of the electrons for the nucleus. The third term is the sum of the repulsion energies between pairs of electrons in that system. Therefore, the Schrödinger equation of the system can be written as minus 1 by 2 sigma I del I square minus sigma I Z by R1 plus 1 by 2 sigma I naught equal to J 1 by Rij into Psi that is equal to E Psi. It is a multi-electron system. Due to the presence of inter-electronic repulsion terms, that is 1 by Rij in the Hamiltonian, it is not possible to solve this Schrödinger equation by the method of separation of variable methods as in the case of hydrogen and hydrogen-like atoms. Therefore, to solve this, we use some approximation methods. With the help of the independent electron approximation method, we assume that the electrons are independent of each other, so that the approximate Hamiltonian is given by H cap dash that is equal to sigma I H cap I that is equal to minus 1 by 2 sigma I del I square minus sigma I Vi, where Vi is the effective one electron potential of the electron I. Let phi 1, 1, phi 2, 2, etc. up to phi n, n are the 1 electron orbitals of the electrons labeled 1, 2, 3, etc. up to n respectively. Then the wave functions for each electron can be written as h cap 1, phi 1, 1 that is equal to E1, phi 1, 1, h cap 2, phi 2, 2 that is equal to E2, phi 2, 2. Similarly, up to n, that is h cap n, phi n, n that is equal to e n, phi n, n, where h cap I in general, h cap I that is equal to minus 1 by 2, del I square minus V I, and E I is the eigenvalue of the h cap I. The combinations of these 1 electron wave functions, that is phi 1, 1, phi 2, 2, etc. up to phi n, n, is used as the first approximation to the true wave function of the system. This is called one electron approximation or independent electron approximation, and we get an approximate solution instead of the true solution of this matter electronic system. If we assume the total wave function of the n electron system as the simple product of n 1 electron functions, then we can write psi 1, 2, 3, etc. up to n, that is equal to phi 1, 1, phi 2, 2, phi 3, 3, up to phi n, n. Then h psi, that is equal to h cap 1, h cap 2, etc. up to h cap n into phi 1, 1, phi 2, 2, etc. up to phi n, n. On expanding this, we know that the phi 1 operate only on h1, therefore h1 phi 1 1 phi 2 2 phi 3 3 phi 4 4 etc. up to phi n n plus h2 phi 2 2 phi 1 1 phi 3 3 phi 4 4 etc. up to phi n n etc. up to h n n phi n n phi 1 1 phi 2 2 phi 3 3 etc. up to phi n minus 1 into n minus 1. This gives the sum of the energy terms plus into multiplied by the wave function time, that is E1 plus E2 plus etc. up to En into phi 1 1 phi 2 2 etc. phi n n, or E1 plus E2 plus etc. up to En into psi. On the other hand, if we assume that the possible overall wave function is given by psi into 1 2 3 etc. up to n, that is equal to phi 1 1 plus phi 2 2 plus etc. up to phi n n, then we can have h psi, that is equal to e 1 phi 1 1 plus e 2 phi 2 2 plus etc. up to e n phi n n, that is not equal to e 1 plus e 2 plus etc. up to e n into psi. This suggests that the only product wave functions that gives the equations of the right form. Thus, the total wave function of many electron system is given approximately by the product of one electron functions, while their total energy is the sum of the one electron energies of the all electrons. If there is no interaction between the spin and orbital motion, we can apply the atomic orbital solutions to the spin eigenfunction of each electron, namely the alpha and beta spin with the spin quantum numbers, that is ms equal to plus 1 by 2 or minus 1 by 2 respectively. Now, the total wave function of each electron is the product of its orbital wave function. It is called a space wave function or orbital and its spin wave function. The combined space and spin wave function of an electron is called spin orbital. Let us write the overall wave function of a multi-electron system as phi 1 1, phi 2 2, etc. up to phi n n, in which the phi 1 is a spin orbital in which that accommodate the electron 1, and phi 2 electron that accommodate electron 2, and so on. But the electrons, we know that the electrons are indistinguishable particles, so there is an equally good another possibility that the overall wave function should be phi 1 2 phi 2 1 phi 3 3 etc. up to phi n, that is the interchanging of electron 1 and 2 between the orbitals phi 1 and phi 2, or any other similar product. In fact, one can write n factorial number of such product functions, which can be obtained by permuting the n electrons amongst the n spin orbitals. Thus, the most general overall wave function will be a linear combination of these n factorial functions. Next, we have to discuss the symmetries of wave functions, or that is fermions and bosons. Consider a system of two electrons labeled by 1 and 2. You know that the electrons are not at all labeled. For our convenience, we can label the electrons as 1 and 2. If the electron 1 is in the state or orbital phi 1 and the electron 2 is in the orbital or state phi 2, then phi 1 1 phi 1 phi 2 2 is the wave function of the system. Similarly, the second possibility, if the electron 2 is in the state of orbital, state or orbital phi 1, and the electron 1 is in the state or orbital phi 2, then phi 1 2, phi 2 1 is the wave function of the system. For a system of 2 electrons, we take the linear combinations of these two. That is, we have to accommodate these two types of permutations, or we have to accommodate these two combinations. That is, psi 1 that is equal to phi 1 1 phi 2 2 plus phi 1 2 phi 2 1, psi 2 that is equal to phi 1 1 phi 2 2 minus phi 1 2 phi 2 1, that is additive and subtractive combinations. By operating the permutation operator, that is p 1 2, which has effect the interchange of two electrons, that is, first we write the orbital functions, additive and subtractive wave functions, and then we apply the permutation operator P12, that is P12 represent the interchange of electrons between the phi 1 and phi 2, that is P12 upon psi 1, that gives phi 1 2 phi 2 1 plus phi 1 1 phi 2 2, that gives plus 1 into psi 1. Similarly, P12 into psi 2 that is equal to phi 1 2 phi 2 1 minus phi 1 1 phi 2 2, that is equal to minus 1 into psi 2. This means that the psi 1 remains unchanged when it is operated on or operated by P12, while psi 2 merely changes the sign. The two functions are therefore the eigenfunctions of the operator P12, with the permutation eigenvalues as plus 1 and minus 1. The psi 1 is symmetric wave function and psi 2 is the antisymmetric wave function. This fundamental principle helps to understand the Pauli antisymmetry principle. The Pauli antisymmetry principle states that the overall wave function of a system must be antisymmetric with respect to the interchange of any pair of electrons. This means that a particular linear combination of n factorial functions, which changes the sign on interchanging the coordinates of any two electrons, is permissible. There are two kinds of particles in quantum mechanics. They are fermions and bosons. And we can state the Pauli's exclusion principle. The statement 1, all acceptable wave functions for the integral spin particle must be symmetrical upon permutation or interchange of the coordinate of the any two particles. That is, a system containing n identical particle is totally symmetric under the permutation of any pair, in which case the particles are said to satisfy Bose-Einstein statics, and hence they are known as bosons. Particles with integer spin, that is 0, 1, 2, 3, etc., are described with symmetric wave functions and are called bosons. Examples are photons, alpha particles, helium atoms, pions, kaons, gluons, etc. They do not obey the exclusion principles. An arbitrary number of the particles can occupy a quantum state with the same quantum number. It can be stated in another way, all acceptable wave functions for half integral spin particles must be antisymmetrical upon permutation or interchange of the coordinates of the two particles. Yes, that is, a system containing n identical particle is totally antisymmetric under the permutation of any pair, in which case the particles are said to satisfy the Fermi-Dirac statics, and these particles are known as fermions. That is, particles with half integer spins, that is 1 by 2, 3 by 2, etc., are described by the antisymmetric wave functions, are called fermions. They obey the Pauli's exclusion principles. Examples are electrons, protons, neutrons, positrons, quarks, muons, etc. An immediate consequence of the electron being a fermion is that it must satisfy this Pauli's exclusion principle, which states that two indistinguishable electrons cannot be in the same state. The Pauli's exclusion principle is valid for all systems of indistinguishable fermions. Next, we have to discuss the antisymmetric wave functions and Slater determinants. We know that the wave functions that describe more than one electron must have two characteristic properties. First, since all the electrons are identical particles, the electron's coordinate must appear in the wave function such that the electrons are indistinguishable. This means that the coordinate of the electrons in an atom or a molecule must enter into the wave functions so that in the many electron probability distribution, that is psi squared, that gives this psi psi star, every electron is identical. The second requirement, and this is the one more complicated and a rigorous statement of the Pauli's exclusion principle, that is the wave function of a system of two or more electrons must change at any time when we permute the coordinate of any two electrons. For example, if we change the coordinate of the two electron 1 and 2 of an alien electron system, that is psi 1, 2, 3, etc. up to n, we get the antisymmetric wave functions, that is equal to minus psi into 2, 1, 3, etc. up to n. This property of fermions in systems with more than one identical fermion, only one probability distribution corresponding to the antisymmetric wave functions are observed. Let us consider a two electron system. If we attempt to construct a two electron wave function as a product of individual electron orbitals phi 1 and phi 2, then neither phi 1 1 phi 2 2 nor phi 1 2 phi 2 1 alone are the satisfactory, since we require that the electrons are indistinguishable. Therefore, we take the linear combinations, that is phi 1 1 phi 2 2 plus or minus phi 1 2 phi 2 1, that do meet the requirements for indistinguishability. But these functions are just describe the spatial distribution of the electrons. We must also consider the spin. If we consider the spatial distribution of the electron, if two electrons have the different spin eigenfunctions, indistinguishability means that neither alpha 1 beta 2 nor alpha 2 beta 1 is satisfactory. But alpha 1 beta 2 plus or minus alpha beta 1 alpha 2 are acceptable, as are alpha 1 alpha 2 and beta 1 beta 2, of course. As we have noted, the overall wave function for the two electron must be antisymmetric with respect to the interchange of electrons labels. This admits four possibilities as long as both phi 1 are singly occupied, that is when the spin multiplicity, that is 2s plus 1 is equal to 1, their ms value, magnetic spin quantum ms, is equal to 0. Therefore, it is represented by the wave function 1 psi, that is equal to symmetry wave function is into antisymmetric spin, that is 1 psi, that is equal to 1 by root 2 into phi 1 1 phi 2 2 plus phi 2 1 phi 1 2 phi 2 1 into 1 by root 2 into alpha 1 beta 2 minus beta 1 alpha 2. It is the antisymmetric spin. For the spin multiplicity is equal to 2s plus 1 3, we have 3 ms values, that is plus 1 0 minus 1. Corresponding to this, we get 3 wave functions psi 3 that corresponding to ms is equal to plus 1, and psi 3 that corresponding to ms is equal to minus 0, and psi 3 3 psi that corresponding to ms is equal to minus 1. So in 1913, Slater introduced the use of determinant to construct antisymmetric wave functions. Slater determinants are constructed using spin orbitals in which the spatial orbitals are combined with the spin functions from the outside. So we use the notation phi 1 1 that is equivalent to phi 1 1 alpha 1 and add a bar over it on the top to indicate the spin down. That is phi bar 1 1 that is equivalent to phi 1 1 beta 1. So we can distinguish the alpha and beta spin. Alpha up spin, for down spin we are writing a bar over the orbital function. Stator determinants are constructed by arranging the spin orbitals in columns and the electron labels in the rows, and then they are normalized by dividing with the normalization constant root of n factorial, where n is the number of occupied spin orbitals. This arrangement is universally understood, so that the notation of the Slater determinants can be made very compact. In the case of two electron, the Slater determinant wave function can be written as psi is equal to 1 by root of 2 factorial into phi 1 1 alpha 1 phi 1 1 beta 1 phi 1 1 phi 1 2 alpha 2 phi 2 2 beta 2, or psi that is equal to 1 by 2 factorial into phi 1 1 phi bar 1 phi 2 2 phi bar 2. In the case of multi-electron systems, the overall wave function, that is Slater determinant, can be written as psi that is equal to 1 by root of 2 n factorial. Here it is written to 1 by root of n factorial into phi 1 1 phi bar 1 phi 2 2 phi 2 1 phi bar 2 etc. up to phi n by 2 1 phi bar n by 2 1. The second row phi 1 2 phi bar 1 2 phi 2 2 phi bar 2 etc. up to phi n by 2 2 phi bar n by 2 2. Similarly, other rows, and finally we get phi n, phi 1 n phi bar 1 n phi 2 n phi bar 2 n etc. up to phi n by 2 n phi bar n by 2 n. Often these elements of the determinant are abbreviated further by using the fact that each orbital in an atom or a molecule can accommodate two electrons. That is, it can accommodate two electrons, one with alpha spin and the other with the beta spin. Therefore, one can write the overall wave function of an n electron system. Suppose the value of n is equal to an even number, then we can write 1 by root of n factorial into determinant of phi 1 1 phi bar 1 2 phi 2 3 phi bar 3 4 etc. up to phi bar n by 2 n, where phi 1 phi 2 etc. up to phi n by 2 are the space part of the orbital, such that phi 1 1 denotes the electron 1 occupying in the orbital phi 1 with the alpha spin, and phi bar 1 2 the electron 2 in the orbital phi 1 with the beta spin. References: Quantum Chemistry, R.K. Prasad. Introductory Quantum Chemistry, A.K. Chandra. And Fundamentals of Quantum Chemistry, R. Andaraman.